Today we are going to discuss the balance part of short term decision making. We have in the previous session we have discussed short term decision making. Under short term decision making we have discussed few areas, and we have discussed about relevant costing. We have discussed about CVP analysis in multi product environment. Thereafter we have discussed about the make or buy decision. Those short term decision making part partially we have covered. The remaining part we need to cover outsourcing, discontinuation decision, further processing decision, and linear programming. Those are the areas which we need to cover in order to complete short term decision making. As I mentioned at the inception, in short term decision making the relevant cost are cash flows, and they are incremental. Therefore historical cost or committed cost are not relevant for decision making. In short term decision making always we are comparing incremental revenue and incremental cost. Based on that we have to make the decision. Therefore in short term, as I mentioned earlier, in short term we can segregate, we can separate cost into fixed and variable. Therefore always we are focusing on incremental cost only, because it is relevant for decision making. Okay, the today's topic under short term decision making remaining part, today we are going to discuss about outsourcing. Okay, why we are going to outsource our service? What might be the reason? Most of the companies, they have outsourced their HR function. Okay, why they are outsourcing? There are main reason to outsource. You can get superior service from those who are expert in that particular area, then you can get a superior service to your organization. On the other hand, you can freeze capital from having separate department for HR. Without having that particular department, you can freeze some capital, you can invest them into another business or by value adding activity. Please keep in mind, when we are outsourcing, we should outsource co-activity or non-co-activities. Therefore we have to outsource non-co-activities, because we can't, sometime we are not going to outsource main activities. Therefore those are the main reasons. And on the other hand, when we are offering it into the subcontract or outsource, those subcontractors or outsource person can or entity can handle our requirement. Their operational flexibility is very high with compared to our operational flexibility. Therefore it is more suitable to outsource or get the external service from external party for the non-co activities of the organization. That is called outsourcing. Okay, we'll look at outsourcing. The relevant cost revenues in decision relating to operating of internal service departments or use external services are differential cost between the two options. That mean if you want to run a own HR department, what would be the cost? If you outsource your HR function to the external party who are expert in that particular area, then what is the cost we need to incur on behalf of the service we are obtaining? The difference between own HR department and you have to compare the cost you have to incur for the outsourcing of HR department. If the internal cost is higher than outsourcing, then you definitely you should outsource your function. Okay, main reasons for outsourcing, there are three reasons it has been mentioned here. Frequently the decision is made on ground that specialist contractors can offer superior quality and efficiency. Without doing it internally, the expert can send superior quality service and they can deliver superior quality service to the organization. Number two, freeze capital from non-co activities and invest them in co activities. Therefore you can freeze those capital and you can invest. As an example, you have allocated half of the floor of your total building for HR department. You can allocate that particular area for your other operation department. Okay, you can increase your efficiency, or you can relocate, or if you outsource your HR department, what will happen? Then you can save some rent expenses as well. Those benefits might be there. You have to compare those incremental cost and incremental benefit of outsourcing. That is about outsourcing. Next one, we are going to discuss about shutdown decisions or discontinuation decision. Why we need to do this, why we are going to discontinue the operation? Sometimes it might generate some losses, or you might find some profitable options to invest. Therefore, when we are going to discontinue any product or product line or service line, you have to compare. If I have closed down this operation, what will happen? Whether I can save cost, whether it will get, you will get benefited, the overall company profitability will go up or down. Therefore, when we are going to make that decision, you have to consider about other factors as well. Okay, shutdown or discontinuance problem can be simplified into short run relevant cost decisions. Okay, number one, if you want to close down the division or product, you can save operating cost. If you want to close down the division, employed need to be redundant, then you have to pay some compensation of loss of office or loss of employment. It is an incremental cost. Okay, ability to realize unwanted non-current assets. Okay, there might be some non-current assets, then you can sell, then you can realize the funds. Relevant cost and revenue should be compared when making the discontinuation decision. Always remember, incremental cost and incremental revenues need to be compared when you are going to make a decision. If your incremental revenue is greater than incremental cost, then you should not close down or discontinue the division or product. Okay. Now we will take an example and we will see how it will work. Example number 11, because we have already discussed 10 questions, then we'll look at example number 11 and see which division should be discontinued or continue in operation. Supreme PLC has three product divisions and their performance for the last year were as follows. Okay, there were three divisions and company as a whole. The total operations being given, their divisional profitability also being provided. Division A, revenue 20 million, variable cost 10 million, contribution 10 million and fixed cost 5 million, net profit they have earned 5 million. Division B, 30 million they have earned as a revenue, variable cost 12.5, contribution 17.5 and fixed cost 20 million. Okay. Division C also generate a profit of 10 million, overall company profitability 12,500,000. That is the total revenue and profit generated by each division. Companies considered to close down division B due to bad performance, because division C is generating a division B generating a loss of 2.5 million. Okay, but remember, they are generating positive contribution. It was noted that rupees 7.5 million is directly attributable fixed cost to division B, which would have been eliminated if the division is closed down. Other fixed cost will remain same. Okay, if you close down division B, you can save 7.5 million which are directly attributable to division B. That means that fixed cost is directly attributable, you can save that cost. Other than that, balance fixed overhead cost you can't eliminate. Determine whether division B should be discontinued or to increase the company profitability. Okay, if without discontinuation, currently company earning 12.5 million as a revenue, net profit. 12.5 million is the net profit. If you look at total contribution says 49.5 million. Now we will see, if we discontinue division B, what will happen to the overall profitability. Okay, I will take example number 11. Example number 11. Now we are going to discontinue division B. I will take division A. Division A. division B and division C. Division A, B and C. Revenue. Now we are going to discontinue division B. Take the total company as all. Total company. Division A, revenue 20 million. Okay. If we discontinue division B, there won't be a revenue. You won't get any revenue. Division C, they will generate 50 million revenue. Okay, 50 million revenue. Now we are discontinuing division B. Total company profitability becomes 70 million. Total company profitability 70 million. Now you need to deduct variable cost. Variable cost. Division A, it is 10 million. 10 million. Division B, there won't be any variable cost because you have closed down the operation, therefore there won't be any operational variable cost. It will be zero. Division C, it is 28 million. 28 million. Total 38 million. Your variable cost is 38 million. Now take the contribution. Contribution. Selling, sales minus variable cost, contribution 10 million, zero contribution for division B, 22 million, total 32 million, total contribution become 32 million. Okay. Now, you have to deduct fixed cost. Fixed cost. Division A, it is 5 million. Okay. Division B, even though it has been closed down, out of 20 million, you can save 7.5 million only. Balance 12.5 million you have to pay. Therefore, it is unavoidable. Therefore, fixed cost of 12.5 million, 20 minus 7.5, 12.5 million you have to anyway, you have to incur. 12.5 million. You can't avoid it. Okay, 12.5 million. Division C, 12 million. 12 million. Now you can take the total. Total become 27.5 million. 27.5 million. Now take the net profit. Net profit. Net profit. Net profit. Here it is 5 million net profit. Here loss of 12.5 million. Loss of 12.5 million. Look at, earlier it was 2.5 million. Now loss has gone up to 12.5 million. Why? Previously, this particular division given a positive contribution of 17.5 million. Okay, there was an unavoidable fixed cost of 7.5 million. After removing that 7.5 million, you have earned a positive net contribution of 10 million. Now it is foregone. Now you are not getting any positive contribution. Here 10 million. If you take the total, 2.5 million is the company profitability. 2.5 million. If you look at previous situation, previous situation, this was 2.5 million only. Why? This division B generated a positive contribution of 17.5 million. If it operated, positive contribution 17.5, that means contribution will increase by 17.5 and additional fixed cost of 5 million. Net difference is 12.5. Sorry, this should be 7.5 million. Additional fixed cost of 7.5 million. Then net impact is 10. That's why your total company profitability has decreased. Okay. If you look at the previous scenario, previous before discontinuation division A 5 million, there was no change. Here it was 2.5 million loss. Division C 10 million. Total was 12.5 million. That means there was a difference of 10 million. That is the net profit you are losing from division B. If you continue this operation, you will able to earn 12.5. If you discontinue division B, you will end up with 2.5 million. 2.5 million as a profit, which has been lower than 12.5 million you have earned earlier. Therefore, due to discontinuation, you have lost exactly 10 million. Therefore, if you lose 10 million, therefore this is not suitable to discontinue. The main reason, division B is generating positive contribution towards the achieving or recovering fixed overhead cost. Positive contribution. Therefore, their incremental contribution is greater than incremental cost saving or incremental cost. Therefore, if you discontinue this division, you have to forget 17.5 million and you will save 7.5 million. Net effect is 10 million. Therefore, you have to write down your decision. Division B should not discontinue since it's generating a positive contribution. Therefore, example 11, we should not discontinue division B. Okay. Now I will move to next topic. Further processing decision. Okay, this is relating to joint product and byproduct. You have to have an idea about what is the meaning of joint product, what is the meaning of byproduct. Okay, I will give a brief summary about joint and byproduct. Based on that, you can get an idea how to work out it. Okay, joint product mean there are some product in order to split, we have to process them in a common process. Okay, as an example, when we are going to make a decision in under crude oil refinery, we will take crude oil into a common process and we have to process them in order to split petrol, diesel and kerosene. Okay, therefore we call the cost incurred in common process we have considered as not relevant for decision making. Okay, this is how it will operate. Assume this is a common process. Now you will put input. I will say crude oil. I'll say 1000 liters. 1000 liters of crude oil I will input to the process. Therefore, the total cost of this process, material, I will say 1 million, overhead, another 1 million, okay. Total, assume 2 million. Total 2 million. This is the operating cost of common process. Then, after processing of this product, there's a point called split off point. At split off point, we have to split the product. Okay, I'll say petrol, diesel and kerosene. I will split assume this 1000 liters I have split into 300 liters of petrol, 200 liters of diesel and 500 liters of kerosene. Okay. Therefore, in joint product costing, the total 2 million we can split by using three methods. By using physical output method, we can divide this 2 million into this basis, based on the output basis. Okay. That is about joint costing. Now, at the split of point, assume there's selling price, price at split, I per liter, I will say, this is a hypothetical value, I will say this one, okay, 1000 liters, I will say this one, 2500 per liter. Okay, 2500. This will be 3000 per liter, price at split. This will be 1500 per liter at this split of point. Now you have to decide whether I am going to further process. Okay, the final price, will be 3500. Okay, if I further process diesel per liter, it will be 4000. Kerosene, if I further process, it will be 2200. Okay, when you are going to further process, incremental cost or further processing cost, assume one of petrol liter you have to further process, additional cost 500 rupees per liter. Diesel, assume it is 1300 per liter, here it is 400 per liter. Now you need to decide whether I am going to further process or not. When you are going to further process or not, what are the relevant cost? When you are going to make a decision for the processing, the cost incurred in common process, is not relevant. Cost incurred in common process is not relevant. The relevant cost and revenue will be when you are going to further process this product, your selling price will increase 2500 to 3500 by 1000 rupees. Your revenue has gone up by, if you further process, if you decide to further process, the price will go up by 1000 rupees, 2500 to 3500 by 1000 rupees. But you have to incur additional cost of 500. Now you need to compare incremental revenue versus incremental cost. Your incremental revenue, how much per unit? 2500 to 3500 mean 1000 rupees. Then your incremental cost is given, incremental cost 500, 500. What would be your decision? Your incremental revenue is greater than your incremental cost, then you should decide this product should further process, further process is required. Okay, because your incremental revenue is greater than your incremental cost. If you look at diesel, your incremental revenue, 3000 to 4000, it is increased by, 1000 rupees. But your incremental cost, cost 1300. Since your incremental cost is 1300, but you can increase your revenue only up by 1000 rupees. Therefore, this is not suitable. Then what we have to do? We have to sell at split of point. Therefore, you can say sell at split. You have to sell at a split. It is not worthwhile to further process because your incremental cost is greater than incremental revenue. If you look at the final one, kerosene, your incremental cost 400, your incremental revenue 1500 to 2200 by 7, 700 rupees, incremental revenue 700, incremental cost 400, incremental revenue 700. Therefore, this particular product, it is worthwhile to further process. It is worthwhile to further process. Okay. Therefore, when we are going to make a decision in further processing decision, the cost incurred in joint process cost is not relevant. When you are going to make this further processing decision, incremental cost and incremental revenue of further processing should be considered. If incremental cost is greater than incremental revenue, you should not process. If your incremental contribution is greater than incremental cost, you have to further process that particular product. Okay, we will look at example number 12. It has been provided some information. Okay, same type of information they have been provided. Look at the illustration. IOC company refines the crude oil in a common process which has incurred rupees 2 million. Remember, for the common operating process, that common operating cost of 2 million is irrelevant when we are going to make further processing decision. After the common process, it has split its main products. Now, company is considering whether these products should be further processed or not after the split of point. Following information being provided, okay, look at product, output in liters being given, price at split of point also being given, further processing cost, final selling price per liter. Common process cost will apportion based on the output at split of point. Determine which product should be further processed. Okay, shall we take petrol? Price at the split of point before further processing, the price 150. If you further process, you have to incur incremental cost of 30 rupees per liter. What is the final selling price? Final selling price is 200. That means your selling price will increase from 150 to 200 by 50 rupees. Therefore, your incremental revenue per liter of petrol is 50. What is the incremental cost? Incremental cost only 30 rupees. Therefore, your incremental cost is lower than your incremental revenue. Therefore, petrol is worthwhile to further process. Diesel, 3,000 units are there. Price at split 100. Further processing cost 20. Final selling price 110. Therefore, your selling price will increase from 100 to 110 by 10 rupees. But you have to incur additional cost of 20 rupees in order to get additional 10 rupee high. Therefore, is it worthwhile? No. The reason is your incremental cost is greater than incremental revenue. Kerosene. The price at split 60 rupees. Okay. Final selling price 80. That means 60 to 80, price will go up by 20 rupees. Okay. When price go up by 20 rupees, 60 to 80, further processing cost only 10 rupees. That means your incremental revenue is 20, your incremental cost only 10. Therefore, kerosene also worthwhile to further process. Okay. Now you can understand that how we have made the decision. You have to compare incremental cost and you have to compare incremental revenue. Now here, incremental cost and incremental revenue we have compared. We have to decide petrol and kerosene we need to further process, and diesel you have to sell at split of point. That is the example number 12. Example number 12 relating to further processing decision. Okay, next one of major topic I am taking, linear programming. Okay, linear programming, that coming under limiting factor analysis, multiple limiting factor analysis. If it is a single limiting factor analysis, we can determine optimal limiting or optimal product mix based on the limiting, single limiting factor. Okay, but here when we are going to analyze optimal product mix based on the multiple constraints, you have to apply linear programming model. Okay, prior to discuss the illustration, I will summarize. Okay, what we need to do. Okay, there are some steps we need to follow. As the first step, we need to define the variables. As an example, if we produce two products X and Y, you have to determine what are the units. You have to find out optimal product mix per month. Therefore, you have to denominate X represent number of units produced during the month. Y represent number of units produced in the given month. Therefore, you have to define what are the variables X, Y, A, B, whatever. You have to define the variable first. Secondly, what we have to do in this as a second step, you have to establish objective function. Establish objective function. Objective function, it is a maximization or minimization. Maximization means you have to maximize profit or contribution. Minimization, you have to minimize cost. Therefore, you have to establish what is your objective function, maximization or minimization. Third, when you are going to maximize your objective or maximize or minimize, when you are going to achieve your objective, there will be constraints. Therefore, third one, in the third step, what we have to do, you have to identify constraints. Identify constraints. What are the constraints available? Okay. Then, when identifying constraint, and you have to establish non-negativity constraint as well. Non-negativity constraint. Constraints. Non-negativity constraint. Okay, based on the constraint, you can identify what are the axis points, and then you can draw the graph, and in the graphical method you can solve the problem, and you can interpret the final matrix. By using final matrix, you can identify the optimal product mix and the changes to the product. Okay, this is how it will work. Now we will see how when we are going to use past paper question, how we are going to answer that particular question, and how to apply linear programming model. Okay, we are referring 2013 December ICSL strategic level 1 question. Okay, strategic level 1 question. Okay, first we will read the illustration. A pharmaceutical manufacturing company is developing three medical compounds X, Y and Z. Okay, there are three compounds X, Y and Z for diabetic patients. For this purpose, four chemicals A, B, C and D are used in different proportions. Okay, the following information has been given to three products. Okay, there are three products XYZ and they are using chemical compound, four chemical compound ABCD, their selling price per kilogram also being given. Okay. Chemical A, B, C and D, the percentage per kilogram also being provided. Price of raw material also being given and maximum availability per month, material A, B and C already provided. And remember, material D, any quantity you can purchase. That means it is not a limited resource. Therefore, only limited resources are material A, material B and material C. The manufacturing cost of each type of compound excluding cost of materials are ₹220 per kilogram. Okay, material conversion cost 220, that means manufacturing cost 220 excluding material. You are required to, part A asks, apply the above data into a linear programming models so that the company will maximize its contribution. Okay, they are going to, their objective is to maximize the contribution, and we need to identify the constraint. What are the constraints available and how we are going to maximize the contribution of the company. Okay, as the first step, step by step, we will establish linear programming model. Okay, as the first step, I am going to define the variable. Define the variables. There are three variables. We need to find out what are the units, how many units we are going to produce from the X, Y, and Z. May X, Y, Z can product to name kochara kapi hadanne yanawada. Therefore, we have defined X. Number of units produced in product X. Number of units produced in product X. Okay, X denominate number of units produced in product X. Y, number of units produced in product Y. There's another product Z, number of units produced in product Z. Okay, now we have defined the variables. Okay, now we have defined the variables. Therefore, there are three products, X, Y and Z. Our objective is to, now we are going to find what is the optimal product mix which maximize the overall contribution. Therefore, in the second step, I need to establish objective function. I need to establish objective function. Okay, I need to establish objective function. How I'm going to establish objective function? It's mentioned here itself. Your company going to maximize its contribution. Therefore, objective equal to maximize contribution. Objective is to maximize contribution. Okay, then how I am going to maximize the contribution? Now we have to establish objective function. Therefore, I need to calculate contribution that you might earn from each product X, Y and Z. Therefore, I will wait for here. Then I have to calculate C. I am going to maximize C. C equal to, now we have to establish the objective function. I have to do some working. Okay. Each product, the total contribution will arise from contribution earned from product X, contribution earned from product Y, contribution earned from product Z. If you take the total contribution, all products should be contributed. Okay, now we are going to find out what is the optimal quantities and their contribution. Product X, Y, Z, selling price. Product X selling price 1660. Product Y, it is 1620. Product Z, also 1620. Okay. Now we will deduct variable cost. Deduct variable cost. Under variable cost, I will take direct material. Direct material. There are four types of material. Material A, B, C, D. And their prices also being provided. Material A price per kilogram, 3000 per kilogram. Price per kilogram, 3000. Material B, 1200 per kilogram. Material C, the value is 2400 kilograms. 2400 per kilogram. Material D, 200 per kilogram. Okay. These are the purchase prices of each material kilogram. Okay. Product X, it will use 10% of material A. Percentage usage is given. Chemical usage percentage makeup per kilogram. A kilogram A will 10% noni. Therefore, A 10%, 3000 into 10%, it should be 300 rupees. Product X. Product Y. Okay, product Y also required 10% from material A. Then again 300. Product Z required 20% from product, so material A. That means 600 rupees. 600 rupees. Chemical B. Product A required, sorry, product X required 10%. Here it 10%, 120. Y required 20%, sorry. Y required 20%, yes, 20%, 240. Is it required 10%, 120. Chemical C, 20% required by X, 480, 10% for Y, 10%, 240, Z also 10%, 240. X, Y and Z all required 60% from material D. 60% from material D mean 120. 120 each. These are the direct material costs attributable to each product. And it says manufacturing cost of each kilogram 220. Manufacturing cost. Manufacturing cost per unit. 220 each product. 220 for each product. Now calculate contribution per kilogram. Contribution per kilogram. Contribution per kilogram. 1660, you have deduct these values, then you can get the contribution per kilogram. Take the value 600, 900, 1020, 1340. This should be 320. 320 per kilogram. 1620 minus, they take the total value. This should be 500. 500. 1620 minus, take the total. Look at the accuracy. 420, 900, 1240. This should be 420. Sorry. This should be 420. Okay. 420, 500 and 320. These are contribution per kilogram. Now, in objective function, my objective is to maximize total contribution of the company. Therefore, still I don't know how many kilograms of X should be produced, how many kilograms of Y and how many kilograms of Z. Therefore, when I am going to establish my objective function, I will say my objective is to maximize the contribution. Total contribution equals to contribution from X, 420 into X mean number of kilograms of units produced in product X, plus 500 into number of kilograms of units produced in product Y, plus 320 into product is said number of unit produced in or kilogram produced in product is said. Therefore, I will establish the objective function 420 X plus 500 Y plus 320 Z. This is your objective function. Okay. When you are going to establish objective function, you have to consider total contribution. Therefore, each product contribution is given here. Contribution per unit into number of unit produced in product X. 500 into number of unit produced in product Y. 320 into number of unit produced in or kilos produced in product is set. This is the objective function. When I am going to achieve this maximum contribution, there are some constraints. What are they? Constraints are availability of material. Material A, B and C, because material D is available at any quantity. Okay, any quantity is available. Okay, one by one we will take the constraint. Number one, constraint number one, material A. Remember, material A total availability 1200. Okay, 1200 available. What is the requirement? 10% total, out of total composition, 10% of material required by product X. 10% also goes to product Y, and balance to 20% should goes to product Z. That is the composition. Therefore, material Z, that means 10% 100 grams should go to X. Why? 10% out of 1 kilogram, that is 100 gram goes to Y. Z, 20% mean 200 gram goes to product Z. But total availability, maximum should not, total utilization should not exceed 1200 kilogram per month. X required 0.1 kilogram per unit. Therefore, if based on number of units produced in product X, the total utilization 0.1x, that means 100 gram each, x number of kilograms or x number of outputs plus. Product Y, it is 0.1y plus 0.2z. This is the total utilization. Therefore, 0.1 into number of kilogram produced in product X, 0.1 into number of kilogram produced in product Y, 0.2 into number of kilogram produced in product Z. This is the total utilization, remember, should be lower than or equal to maximum available quantity of 1200 kilograms. Okay, this is equation number 1, 1200 kilograms. Okay. Then we'll take material B. Material B, product X required 10%, that means 0.1x plus. Material B required 0.2y plus 0.1z. Maximum availability, this is the actual, the utilization should not exceed the maximum available quantity of 2000 kilograms. 2000. This is the second equation. Third equation, material C. Product X required 20%, that means 0.2x plus 0.1y plus 0.1z less than or equal maximum availability 2200 kilograms. This is equation 3. Then those are the main three constraints when you are going to achieve the maximum contribution. Therefore, now you need to introduce non-negativity constraint. What is the meaning of non-negativity constraint? This X, Y, Z, those are the product units. Max minimum should be zero but not negative. Therefore, in non-negativity constraint, I will say fourth step, non-negativity constraint, either X, Y or Z should be greater than or equal to zero. That means should not fall below zero. There won't be any negative output. Okay, it should be greater than or equal to zero. This is the non-negativity constraint, or this is the total linear programming model we have constructed. This is the way of constructing linear programming model. Okay, even we can find out the axis points, you know, if you are going into graphical approach, then you can draw the graphical chart and you can identify the feasible region. Okay, that is part A of the illustration. Now we will look at part B. Construct the initial simplex tableau and explain terms of slack variables. Consider A, B and C as slack variables for ABC, material ABC. Okay, material A, B and C, we considered slack variable. That means slack variable mean unutilized resources. Till we finalize the optimal solution, product material A, B, C we'll consider as slack variables. Therefore, these are product variable and slack variable. We have to identify what are the main variable, slack variable and binding variable and slack variable will identify in the final solution as well. But when we are going to construct initial table, we have to introduce slack variables. Slack variable mean the resources which has not been utilized, unutilized resources, the amount of unutilized resources. Prior to construct, okay, prior to construct initial tableau, I have to convert these equations, these inequalities, asamanata, inequalities into equations. Therefore, I have to rewrite the equation prior to construct the linear programming or initial tableau. I will take equations with slack variable. Equations with slack variables. Okay, first one I will take material A. Equation I will write down 0.1x. 0.1x plus 0.1y plus 0.2z. This is the utilization, total utilization. Okay, total utilization of material A. Slack variable of material A we call, consider as simple A. Simple A mean unutilized material of material A. Therefore, utilization plus unknown material not utilized equal to 2400. Okay, this is equation number one. Okay, this is the total utilization plus unutilized resources. Total should equal to 2400. If these are zero, then unutilized resources equal to 2400. Then equation number 2, material B, equation 0.1x plus 0.2y plus 0.1z plus, these are the utilization of material B plus unutilized resource of material B, that is the slack variable, equal to maximum availability of 2000. This is the equation number 2. Then final one, material C. Material C, what will happen? Material C, 0.2x. Plus 0.1y plus 0.1z plus, these are the utilization of material C plus unutilized resource of material C equal to 2200. This is the third equation. Okay, now I have introduced slack variable. This is the slack variable of material A. This is slack variable of material B. This is the slack variable of material C. Slack variable mean unutilized resources. Okay, that is the part, the next part, part B. Now we are going to look at part C, interpretation of final matrix. Okay, final matrix being given. Okay, final matrix being given. When we are going to calculate or when you are going to resolve this problem, you need to interpret the final matrix. In the solution column, it's given the solution, that means it include optimal product mix, it include unutilized resources and maximum contribution will be included. Okay, in the product column, product X, Y, Z, they are product variable. Okay, if it appears only one and others are zero, that means they are in optimal solution. Okay, if there's a shadow price, or if product column include other than 0 and 1 any other values there, then it is not an optimal solution. Okay, if you look at this illustration, product X only contain 1 and others are 0. In row which 1 appears, if you go to the solution cell, it will be 4000 units. If you go to the Y, only 1 and other cells are 0. That means when where the 1 appear, move to the right side, then you will get in the solution column the total output. Look at Z. If you look at Z, it says that if you produce Z, your contribution will fall by 1 unit. If you produce from Z, you will lose 440 from your total contribution. Okay, now we are going to interpret final matrix. When you are going to interpret, it will be very easy. When you receive the final matrix like this, then it is very easy to interpret it. We will start with product mix. In the product mix, the variable only can include 1 and zeros. 1 and zeros. That means there won't be any opportunity cost of producing it. There's no shadow price of it. Why? Your contribution. Okay. Optimal production quantities. Optimal product mix. Product mix. X, Y, and Z. X. If you go to X column, 1 appear here. If you move to the right side solution row, or solution column, you will get that particular cell 4000 units. 4000 units. 4000 units. Product Y. If you look at product Y, it's there in optimal product mix. 1 and other cells are 0. Where it appears 1, move to the right side. You can find in the solution column, the output is 8000. 8000. 8000 units. Product is said is nil. Why? It is not recommended to produce because it has an opportunity cost of production. If you produce 1 unit of Z, you will lose 440 as a contribution. Okay, that is optimal production quantity. Resource utilization. Okay, in resource utilization, there are 3 slack variables. A, B and C. That means material A, material B and material C. If you have fully utilized, that means there will be a shadow price. There will be a additional cost. If you receive an additional unit, you can increase your contribution. If you look at solution row here, solution row, if you increase or decrease, this is the impact. That means they have been fully utilized. They are binding resource. What is the meaning of binding resource? Resource which has been fully utilized. A and B, material A and B fully utilized. If you look at C, in the solution row, opportunity cost is 0. Opportunity cost is 0 mean there's no opportunity cost. There's no opportunity cost mean there excess resources are available. Opportunity cost will arise here if you have fully utilized the resources. Therefore, in resource utilization, or you can say as unutilized resources. Okay, we call or resource utilization. Material A, B, and C fully utilized. Same, fully utilized. But material C, there's a quantity. If you go to 1 in the right side in solution column, there is a quantity of 600 kilograms. Therefore, 600 kilograms, this is called unutilized resources. Therefore, if you look at the resource utilization, material A and B fully utilized, material C is not fully utilized, unutilized. That means it is a slack variable still. And these two, the resources being fully utilized, we can call binding resources. Therefore, material A and B, both we consider as binding resources. Then shadow prices of fully utilized resources, therefore material A and B fully utilized. Therefore, material A and B, since fully utilized, if you look at material A, if you lose 1 kilogram of material A, your contribution will lose by 3,400. Therefore, shadow price. I'll take shadow price here. Material A, it calls A, simple A, that is material A. Your shadow price per kilogram of material, 3,400. Material B, it is 800. Okay, shadow price of fully utilized resources. Effect of production of items not in the optimum product mix. That is mean if you produce item not in optimum product mix, what will happen? Your total contribution will lose by 440. Effect on, I'll take effect on, production now, producing product Z. If you produce product Z, overall contribution will reduce by how much? 440. Overall contribution will reduce by 440. Okay. Contribution, total contribution, will fall by, 440 rupees. If you produce 1 unit of Z, your contribution will fall by 440. Okay, 440. Therefore, that need to be keep in mind. If you produce 1 unit of Z, the impact is losing of 440 as a contribution. You will lose a contribution of 440. If you want to look at the effect on product mix, okay, effect on product mix, it will be a negative impact. Okay, therefore currently X 4000 unit, I take 4000 kilograms, okay, 4000 kilograms instead of units, I will take, these are kilograms. If you produce 1 kilogram of Z, you have to sacrifice 3 kilogram of X minus 3 kilogram. Then it, this become 3,997 kilograms. Y, 8,000 kilogram, it be a negative impact, minus minus 1 kilogram, it become plus 8001 kilograms. Z only 1 kilogram. This will be the effect on product mix. This is the new product mix. Remember, this product mix will lose 440 as a contribution. As an example, here contribution per unit is 420. You will lose 420 into 3 kilograms, you are losing 1260. This is a cost. You are losing 1260 production from Z. But why? 1 kilogram it has gone up. That means you will get additional 500. 1 kilogram of Z will give 320. Now take the net impact. Net impact due to change in the product mix. Net impact is 440. That means if you produce Z, 1 unit of Z, your total contribution will fall by 440. That means Z is not in the optimal product mix. Okay, current contribution, 5,680,000. Okay, total contribution, contribution 5,680,000. That is the value they are in last sale. Or otherwise, you can calculate it here by using your earlier formula. We have established the objective function. 420x plus 500y into 320z. Okay, this total value will be 5,680,000. It's there in the last cell of your final matrix. And it says, utilization of other resources, if an additional 1 kilogram of fully utilized resources is made available. Okay, if you receive, okay, now this iteration is more important. If you receive 1 additional kilogram of material, what will happen to the product mix? What will happen to the unutilized resources? And what will happen to the total contribution? You have to work it out. Now you will receive 1 kilogram of additional resources. Okay, we'll look at material A. What will happen? Okay, I will take number 1. Additional 1 kilogram of material A. If you receive additional 1 kilogram of material, okay, what will happen to the product mix? Okay, product mix, impact to the product mix. Product mix, X and Y, because we are not producing Z. Current product mix, 4000 kilogram of X and 8000 kilogram of Y. Okay. If you receive 1 kilogram of material, it will help to, it will have a positive impact. Because your output, anyway, your output contribution can improve. Therefore, we have to add. If you receive 1 kilogram of material, look at product X. Okay, product X. It will go up by 20 units. Therefore, if you receive 1 kilogram, your output will increase by 20. Therefore, 4020. If you increase 1 kilogram, it is increased by 20 kilogram. Oh, sorry, just 20 units. If you increase 1 kilogram of material A, what will happen to material B? If you increase 1 kilogram of material A, it will be a negative impact of 10 unit. This becomes 7,990 kilograms. If you receive 1 additional kilogram of material A, this is the impact. Okay. Then unutilized resources. Unutilized resources. See, Currently, unutilized resources are 600 plus 1 into minus 3. Minus 3. That means this becomes 597. That means unutilized resources will be utilized by additional 3 kilogram. If you receive 1 additional kilogram of material A, this is the impact to the product mix, this is the impact to the unutilized resources. What is the impact to the contribution? Impact to the contribution. Contribution. No need to work out 4000 into contribution per unit, 4020 into contribution per unit, 7900 into contribution per unit of Y. You can take like that as well. Oh, current contribution. Current contribution 5,680,000. If you receive one additional kilogram of material A, it says shadow price is 3,400. If shadow price is 3,400, mean if you receive 1 kilogram of material, you will receive additional 3,400 as contribution. Therefore, shadow price, or you can take incremental contribution. Your incremental contribution 1 kilogram, you will receive 1 kilogram each 3,400. If you add it, 3,400, your total contribution goes up to 5,683,400. Your contribution also will improve. Same as if you receive material 1 kilogram of additional material of material B. Same thing happen. Additional one kilogram of material B. If you receive additional 1 kilogram of material B, how it impact to product mix? You have to refer the final matrix. Look at slack variable. It is a binding resource column. If you receive 1 kilogram of material B, it will affect to reduce output by 10, output will reduce by 10 units of product X, and it will increase output by 10 units of product Y. Therefore, X and Y, X currently 4000 kilograms, Y 8000 kilograms plus. If you receive 1 kilogram of material, this is the impact. 10 unit, it will be negative, 1 into minus 10, then it will be 3,990 kilograms. Y, 1 into, the output will increase by another 10 unit, aka if you receive 1 kilogram of material B, total output of Y will increase by 10 units. Therefore, it becomes 8,010 kilograms. Okay, unutilized resources will increase. Unutilized resources. That is material C. Currently 600 kilograms plus 1 into 1. That becomes 601 kilograms. 601 kilograms. Contribution, it will go up by 800. Each unit you receive, if you receive 1 kilogram of material B, your total contribution will go up by 800. Therefore, new contribution equal 5,680,000 plus 1 kilogram into, each kilogram will give 800. Therefore, 5,680,800. this is the new contribution. That's how it will impact to the total product mix, unutilized resources and new contribution. That's how it will work. Now we will move to the next one, part D. Use the final matrix above. Okay, we need to use the final matrix above. Estimate the effects of an increase in A of 100 kilogram per month. If you receive 100 kilogram per month, what would be the impact? 4000 kilogram. This is if you increase 1 kilogram. If it receive 100 kilograms, product mix 100 into 20, then it will go up by 2000. 100 into 10, it will reduce by 1000. Okay, we will apply here as well, not additional 1 kilogram of material. Then now we will look at iterations given. If you receive additional 100 kilograms of material, what will happen? Product mix, unutilized resources and to the contribution. Okay, this is part D1. Estimate the effect of an increase of a kilogram, 100 kilogram per month, product this into, if you receive material A, each kilogram will increase 20, output by 20. Therefore, 100 kilogram if you receive, this is a plus point, 20, this becomes 6000 kilograms. If you receive 100 kilograms, product Y will decrease, each kilogram product Y will reduce by 10 units, that means minus 10. This becomes 7000 kilograms. 7000 kilograms. Unutilized resources, if you receive additional 1 unit of material A, unutilized resources will increase or reduce by 3 kilograms. Therefore, plus 100 into minus 3. Then unutilized resources will fall up to 300 kilograms. Therefore, total contribution equal to 5,680,000 is the current contribution plus, okay, additional contribution. If you receive 1 kilogram of material A, each kilogram will increase your total contribution by 3,400. Therefore, if you receive 100 kilogram, how much it would increase? It will increase by 340. Okay. 6,020,000 is the total contribution. Total contribution is 6,020,000. Okay. Estimate the effect of an increase of A of 100 kilogram per month. Okay. Estimate the effect of a contract from an influential customer for a minimum 200 kilogram of Z to be supplied. If you supply 200 kilograms of Z, your total contribution will fall by 440 each unit, 440 into 200 units, 88,000. Your total contribution will fall. Okay, this is part one. We'll look at part two. Now we are going to produce, there's an influential customer. He is asking to supply 200 units of product Z. Remember, product Z is not in optimal product mix. If you produce product Z, part two, product Z, how it impact to the product mix? X. Currently 4000 kilograms you are producing. If you produce any output other than the optimal product mix, there will be a negative impact. Therefore, minus. X will reduce by each unit you producing in product. Is it product X will reduce by 3 units or 3 kilograms. 3 kilograms into 200 6 kilograms it will lose, that means 3400 kilograms. It will be 3400 kilograms, product X. If you look at product Y, currently they are producing 8000 kilograms minus. If you produce 200 units of Z each, you are losing 1 kilogram, 1 into 200, minus into minus become plus, then this become 8200 kilograms, 8200 kilograms. Then Z, you will produce Z, you will produce 200 kilograms. Okay. Now if you calculate the contribution, now you will get the new contribution and you will lose your contribution. We'll calculate it. Oh, unutilized resources. Unutilized resources. See, 600 kilograms minus effect minus 0.04. Yes, minus 0.4 into 200. This becomes 680 kilograms. Unutilized resources also will go up. Then contribution, you can calculate X, Y, Z how much by using C equal, if you use the objective function, you can calculate this, or you can easily take your shadow price, so opportunity cost of producing Z is 440, okay, opportunity cost. If 440 per unit, if you produce 200 unit, what is the total opportunity cost of producing Z? Or otherwise, you can calculate C equal. Can you remember the objective function we have written down at the inception? 420X plus 500Y plus 320Z. If you multiply, then you will receive an answer. The answer is 88,000 lower than current amount you are earning. Contribution will be C equal 5,680,000 is there. It will be 5,592,000 is the new contribution. New contribution. That means, therefore, contribution will reduce by 88,000. Contribution will reduce by 88,000. That means 88,000 mean 200 units into 440 each. 440 each. That is the answer for part 2 of the illustration. Part 3. Recommend the appropriate course of action if additional 500 kilogram per month of chemical A are offered at 4000 per kilogram. Okay. Now material A is short in supply. Okay. You have to determine what is the optimum or maximum amount you are willing to pay. Therefore, your maximum amount will restrict to additional contribution that you can earn. If you look at material A, if you receive an additional 1 kilogram of material, it will give 3400 as a contribution. Therefore, you will expect to pay maximum up to additional 3500 per unit. Currently, your purchase price of material A is how much? Purchase price of material A currently you are purchasing at 3000, they are asking to purchase at 4000. Okay, we'll see. Now they are offering the price of 4000 to purchase 500 kilogram of material. Then first you have to determine what is the maximum price you are willing to pay. Okay, maximum price you are willing to pay. This maximum price include current purchase price plus shadow price per kilogram. Maximum additional price, current purchase price, price per kilogram is 3000. Is 3000 plus shadow price per kilogram, shadow price per kilogram of A. It is given in the final matrix 3400. Therefore, your maximum purchase price for additional 1 kilogram of material should not go beyond 6400. This is the maximum price you are willing to pay. 6400 is the maximum purchase price. Maximum purchase price. What is the supplier offered price? Supplier has offered 4000. Yes. If we offer 4000 rupees, we will get 6400. Maximum we are willing to go up to 6400. If you are able to purchase at 4000, you can save 2400 as a contribution, incremental contribution 2400. Then 2400 into 500 kilograms, you can calculate what is the additional contribution that you can earn. Therefore, external supplier price, external supplier price, external supplier price, how much? 4000. Deduct. This is the incremental contribution per unit, incremental contribution per kilogram 2400. Incremental contribution per kilogram 2400. Then you can recommend this is suitable to purchase at 4000 at a higher price than the normal price. The total quantity purchased, quantity to be purchased, 500 kilograms. Then total incremental contribution 2400 into 500 kilograms, it will be 1.2 million. Your contribution will able to increase by 1.2 million if you receive 500 additional kilogram of material A at a price of 4000, then you will able to increase your output and you can additionally earn 1.2 million over this additional 500 kilogram of material. Therefore, you can recommend third one, this is suitable to purchase at 4000. This is option 3 or sub question 3. Final one, recommend the appropriate course of action if additional 500 kilogram per month of chemical B are offered at 3200. Okay, that is material B, this is material A. Now they are offering at 3200. You have to look at with current purchase price plus what is the shadow price. If it is lower than external purchase price, you should not purchase. If it is greater than external purchase price, what you have to do, you have to purchase it. Current purchase price of material B, okay, we'll take, this is fourth one, material B, material B, current purchase price, current purchase price, how much is it? Current purchase price of material B, 2000. Material B is 2000. 2000. You have to add shadow price. Shadow price of 1 kilogram of per kilogram of material B. Shadow price is given 800 rupees per kilogram. 800 rupees per kilogram. Then you will receive. This is the maximum price you are willing to pay. 2800 maximum price. Maximum price. Maximum price you are willing to pay 2400. Clear? Then what is the supply offered price? Supply offered price 3200. Okay. External supplier price. External supplier price 3200. Now what is your suggestion? You should not purchase, because your max, you are willing to pay maximum 2800 if you acquire 1 kilogram of material external supply price 3200. You will lose your contribution. Therefore, this should recommend, should not purchase, should not purchase, not purchase, because your maximum price limited to 2800. Okay, 2800. Okay, just we have completed linear programming. Now I will wrap up the things what we have discussed under short term decision making. Under short term decision making, we have start up with break even analysis. In the break-even analysis, under multi-product break-even analysis, we have analyzed optimal or maximum break-even point when multi-product environment, with assuming that constant product mix. If when the constant product mix is there, how to calculate break-even point in terms of value, in terms of quantity or optimal product mix. When you are going to calculate break-even point in units, what we have calculated, contribution per mix we have taken, then total fixed cost divided by contribution per mix, then number of mixtures, and then we have allocated into number of units. When we are going to calculate in terms of value, we have calculated average CS ratio. Based on average CS ratio, we have calculated sales value. Thereafter, we have discussed about relevant costing. In the relevant costing, what you need to keep in mind? In relevant cost, always we are discuss about the incremental cost, and we will consider about the cash flow items, and it will be incurred in future. Historical cost and non-cash flow item we should not consider. Thereafter, we have discussed about the relevant cost of material, relevant cost of labor, machinery user cost we have discussed. Then special pricing decision. Normally, special pricing decision will come when we have a spare capacity. Customers, special customers might ask the prices lower than our price, market prices, current selling prices. Then you need to decide whether order should be accepted or not. That is special pricing decision. Thereafter, make or buy decision. We have to look at whether in-house production is favorable than external purchase. You have to compare marginal cost of in-house production against the external supplier price. If external supplier price is greater than marginal cost of in-house production, you should produce in-house. If it is not, you have to outsource or you have to purchase from outside. Then outsourcing decision we have discussed. In outsourcing, it is suitable to outsource non-core activity, and if you want to get expert service, then it is better to outsource those particular activities. Then next one we have discussed about about the discontinuation decision. When you are going to close down a decision, division or product, you have to look at whether it generate incremental contribution. You have to compare incremental cost against the incremental revenue. Based on that, we have to make a decision. Sometimes discontinuation decision may affect to reduce overall profitability, why some of fixed costs cannot be avoided. Therefore, you have to make the decision based on contribution. Okay, some of costs cannot be avoided. Then we have discussed about further processing decision. Again, we have to compare incremental cost of further processing against the incremental revenue of further processing. Finally, we have discussed about linear programming. In linear programming, we have to discuss when there's a multi constraints available, then we have to, how do we develop the linear programming model and how to interpret the final matrix. Okay, those are the areas which we have discussed through the first and current session. Two sessions we have completed for short term decision making, which is relevant for your examination, and we will meet in the next session on a separate topic which is helpful for your examination.